Welcome to ASEAN. The history of ASEAN started in 1967.
On August 8, 1967, five leaders, the foreign ministers of Indonesia, Malaysia, the Philippines, Singapore, and Thailand, sat down together in the main hall of the Department of Foreign Affairs building in Bangkok, Thailand.
Can you guess who were those five foreign ministers?
First, Adam Malik of Indonesia. Second, Narciso Rueca Ramos of the Philippines. Third, Tun Abdul Razak of Malaysia. Fourth, Sinathamby Rajaratnam of Singapore. And fifth, Thanat Koman of Thailand. They were subsequently hailed as the founding fathers of ASEAN, and they signed a document. By virtue of the document, the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, abbreviated as ASEAN, was born. The date, 8th of August, is now celebrated as ASEAN Day. And then, the document that the five leaders signed would be known as the ASEAN Declaration or Bangkok Declaration. ASEAN Declaration contains five articles and states the basic principles of ASEAN: cooperation, amity, and non-interference. The five foreign ministers spent 4 days in the relative isolation of a beach resort in Bangsayan, a coastal town less than 100 kilometers southeast of Bangkok. There, they negotiated over the document in a decidedly informal manner, which they would later delight in describing as sport-shirt diplomacy.
Why those five leaders created ASEAN?
The aim is to improve economic, political security, and socio-cultural cooperation among its member states. Moreover, the creation of ASEAN was initially motivated as a display of solidarity against communist expansion in Vietnam and communist insurgency within their own borders.
But how communism entered Southeast Asia? Let's see what happened before 1967.
Communism had taken a foothold in mainland Asia with the Soviet Union's occupation of the Northern Korean Peninsula after World War II. The Soviet Union, known as Russia now, established communist governments in North Korea in 1945, in the People's Republic of China in 1949, and portions of former French Indochina with North Vietnam in 1954, accompanied by the communist insurgency emergency in British Malaya and unrest in the recent independent Philippines from the USA in the early 1950s. At the time, the Filipino government struggled to give amnesty to former Hukbalahap militants who staged an armed conflict in Luzon during the 1950s that almost led to the collapse of the central government. On the other hand, the conflict between the Indonesian military and the increasing Indonesian Communist Party apparently came to an end in the late 1965 with the transition to the dictatorship of Suharto's New Order after the horror of the Indonesian mass killings of 1965-66 being implemented. Another related matter was the formation of Malaysia. In 1961, Malayan Prime Minister Tunku Abdul Rahman announced a proposal to create a new federation. The idea was to merge the Federation of Malaya, Sarawak, Singapore, and North Borneo into one entity called Malaysia. This was opposed by Indonesia and the Philippines because Indonesia believed the new formation was a form of neocolonialism, while the Philippines claimed Eastern North Borneo or Sabah as part of its territory. To diffuse tension, a non-political confederation called Mapilindo was formed. However, this confederation was not successful due to the perception that Mapilindo was formed to delay or prevent the formation of Malaysia. Despite opposition, Malaysia was formed in 1963. This led to the Indonesia-Malaysia confrontation.
Rakyat Malaya, Singapura, Sabah, Sarawak, dan Brunei untuk membubarkan negara boneka Malaysia.
And then the Philippines withdrew diplomatic ties, causing relations to remain sour until the creation of ASEAN. In 1965, Singapore was expelled from the Federation over racial tensions and how the Federation should be governed, but remained a capitalist democratic society with close ties with its new neighbors. And in 1967, Vietnam War happened. The Vietnam War was a long, costly, and divisive conflict that pitted the communist government of North Vietnam against South Vietnam and its principal ally, the United States. The conflict was intensified by the ongoing Cold War between the United States and Soviet Union. It is believed that the creation of ASEAN has prevented hostilities between Southeast Asian states.
So what's next after ASEAN was born?
Indonesia would fully restore diplomatic relations with Malaysia and soon after that with Singapore. That was by no means the end to intra-ASEAN disputes, for soon the Philippines and Malaysia would have a falling out on the issue of sovereignty over Sabah. Many disputes between ASEAN countries persist to this day, but all member countries are deeply committed to resolving their differences through peaceful means and in the spirit of mutual accommodation. Every dispute would have its proper season, but it would not be allowed to get in the way of the task at hand. And at the time, the essential task was to lay the framework of regional dialogue and cooperation. The original ASEAN logo presented 5 brown sheaves of rice stalks, one for each founding member. Beneath the sheaves is the legend ASEAN in blue. These are set on a field of yellow encircled by a blue border. Brown stands for strength and stability, yellow for prosperity, and blue for the spirit of cordiality in which ASEAN affairs are conducted. 1976, the first ASEAN summit convened in Bali, Indonesia, resulting in an agreement on several industrial projects and the signing of a Treaty of Amity and Cooperation and a Declaration of Concord. Also, in 1976, Papua New Guinea received observer status to ASEAN. 1977, ASEAN Preferential Trading Agreement in Manila, the Philippines. 1978, first ASEAN European Economic Community Ministerial Meeting held in Brussels. 1984, Brunei joins ASEAN's 6th member. 1992, ASEAN Free Trade Area Agreement on the Common Effective Preferential Tariff in Singapore. 1994, ASEAN establishes the ASEAN Regional Forum, which is focused on security interdependence in the Asia-Pacific region. Besides ASEAN member states, The present participants include Australia, Canada, China, European Union, India, Japan, South Korea, North Korea, Mongolia, New Zealand, Pakistan, Papua New Guinea, the Russian Federation, and the United States. 1995, Vietnam joins ASEAN's seventh member. Also, ASEAN Framework Agreement on Services and Treaty on the Southeast Asia Nuclear Weapon Free Zone. 1997, the first meeting of ASEAN plus 3, comprising leaders of the 10 ASEAN members and their counterparts from East Asia, China, Japan, and South Korea. Laos and Myanmar joined ASEAN's 8 and 9 members in 1997. 1997 also marked the 30th anniversary of ASEAN. Interestingly, the shapes on the logo had increased to 10, representing all 10 countries of Southeast Asia and reflecting the colors of the flags of all of them. In a real sense, ASEAN and Southeast Asia would be the one and the same, just as the founding fathers had envisioned. 1998. The two-day ASEAN summit opens in Hanoi, Vietnam. Cambodia is admitted formally. The Asian nations approve the Hanoi Action Plan, a 34-point declaration that emphasizes economic recovery based on free market policies. Also, in 1998, ASEAN Investment Agreement in the Philippines. 1999, Cambodia joins ASEAN's 10th member. 2000, the Chiang Mai Initiative is set up to help East Asian cash-strapped countries defend their currencies in times of trouble. The initiative comes in response to the 1997 East Asian financial crisis. ASEAN, China, Japan, and South Korea launched the multilateral agreement of currency swaps. 2001. From the year of 2001, the ASEAN summit takes place annually. It is a meeting of the heads of state and government to discuss current problems and find out the best possible solutions. 2002, China and ASEAN agree to a China-ASEAN free trade area to be implemented in stages up to 2015. 2005, the first meeting of ASEAN plus 6, also called the East Asia Summit, comprised of the ASEAN countries plus China, Japan, South Korea, India, Australia, and New Zealand. 2006, ASEAN was given observer status at the United Nations General Assembly. In response, ASEAN was awarded the status of dialogue partner to the UN. 2007, ASEAN signed a charter giving its 10 member states a legal identity, a first step towards its aim of a free trade area by 2015 called the ASEAN Economic Community Blueprint in the Philippines. 2008, the Association of Southeast Asian Nations moved to forge an EU-style community, signing a charter that makes the bloc a legal entity. This could pave the way for creating a single market within 7 years. 2010, a free trade agreement between China and the 10 members of the ASEAN comes into effect. The 6 richest members scrap tariffs on 90% of goods. The 4 poorest, Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos, and Myanmar, will not need to cut tariffs to the same level until 2015. 2013, ASEAN members and their trading partners, Australia, China, India, Japan, New Zealand, and South Korea begin the first round of negotiations on the establishment of the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. 2015, the ASEAN Economic Community Blueprint is adopted by ASEAN leaders at the 27th ASEAN Summit. This blueprint provides broad direction to achieve a highly integrated and cohesive economy. 2017, ASEAN and China finished drafting a legally binding code of conduct in the South China Sea. 2020, ASEAN Banking Integration Framework. 2022, Timor Leste receive observer status to ASEAN.
Welcomes in principle Timor Leste's eventual membership in ASEAN. Prime Minister Lee Hsien Loong says that the membership should take place with an objective, criteria-based ASEAN roadmap.
Today, ASEAN becomes one of the most successful intergovernmental organizations in the developing world.
We are ASEAN, so you and I, we all want to make ASEAN a better place. So what is your idea to make a better ASEAN? Please give your comment below and let's see what happened to be ASEAN.